So Michael Devecka has been an audio enthusiast for 50 plus years, collecting records, new and old, as well as vintage phonographs, and occasionally indulging in modern equipment. His main focus, though, is the decades of the 1920s, which was important technically and musically. Michael Devecka is going to present for us a historic audio demonstration, state-of-the-art 1925, the orthophonic Victrola Credenza compared to the Victor talking machine.
Here you go.
Also, I want to introduce my wife, Carolyn, who is being very helpful here. And we're going to actually stretch the state-of-the-art concept. It's really sort of continuum of the mechanical machine from, say, around 1903 to 1925, showing how the art changed as well. So we're going to try to hit a lot of little bases in a short period of time. And I'm not going to do a lot of talking. We're going to let these guys do the job. So. First, Rick, sorry guys, forget about these things. I'm not going to give a lot of intro. June 1924, April 1927, you'll recognize the tune in about a nanosecond.
Turn the projector off.
Yeah, but we lose the projector for this. Technical difficulties, guys.
You don't play those with a needle, do you?
Well, modern technology.
All the needles I've used 10 times. This is ruin the record day.
Thank you.
little excerpt from Rhapsody in Blue, the acoustic version recorded in, like I said, June 1924, electrical version recorded in April of 1927. I'm playing these at 74 RPM, in part because very smart people told me it's probably not a bad speed. And when you listen to the whole thing through, it makes sense. Started with this because A, it's recognizable. B, one of the tricks with the playlist for this type of presentation is finding material that was recorded both acoustically and electrically that A, is listenable and is common enough that you can have multiple copies. Because let me assure you something, we're not playing mint records. All the mint records stay someplace else and go with new equipment. So, you know, no mint records were harmed in the making of this. We knew that one was going to come. Okay, so we got that out of the way. Except I do play my mint Berliners on this, but that's a separate issue. Okay, okay. Now, one of the complaints with the acoustic process was it was never very good with massed instruments, which is why I started with an orchestra. And next we will go to a band, again, a song you will recognize within a nanosecond, mainly because that's what got recorded a lot, and we can go back into the 1890s. We'll have a Berliner, one that's been somewhat torched. 1899, 1909, and then a 1927 version of this. And this is band. And again, showing the contrast, what they're doing. And you'll hear some performance differences, obviously, and sound differences. I got a great script, you can see that.
Recognize it?
we're going to adhere to the proper rules. Sorry, overruled. Okay, I'll tell you what.
Were all of those different Sousa bands?
Sorry? Oh, yeah. Sousa, U.S. Marine. The electrical is U.S. Marine. So tell you what, I'm getting tired of chasing records for a second, so I will say something. So let me introduce the cast of characters. Over here in this corner, yeah, my wife, of course, this corner right here, this is a Victor P. This was a premium machine, and it served as stand-in for a Berliner. By premium, this was a machine that Victor sold to merchants, and they could in turn give away, you know, when a client did X amount of business. But it basically has the same technology as the very early Victors, which you can hear, of course. This is a Victor 5 circa about, that's 1903-1904. This is a Victor 5 circa 1910, thereabouts, in production from about 1904-5 in this form through 1920. This was their biggest sized machine, wasn't their most expensive as far as this series. This is a Victor. And in Victor world, a Victor meant open horn machine. Mm-hmm. Open horn, this puppy. This is a Victrola. That meant horn inside cabinet. And of course, what's missing is the domed lip job in the middle here, which I didn't bring because that's another 100 and some pounds. The orthophonic credenza. Orthophonic Victrola Credenza model is the correct term. The numeric designation was an 8-1, so there's all the Victor info. Circa fall 1925. Why fall 1925? Two doors, stylistic change. Now, this is basically, technologically, a continuum. They're all the same basic things. A reproducer hooked to a horn. The big difference here is some smart guys at Western Electric, Bell Labs, you know, depending on what date you're looking at and the assignation of patents, developed this system. The Western Electric recording system, Western Electric mechanical playback, and bits and pieces of electrical playback, plus they were working on movie, which is beyond my pay grade. The recording system was offered, the whole system was offered to Columbia and Victor. Victor bought pretty much everything, Columbia bought the recording. And so that's why I'm using Victor. For one, is because Victor uses the Western Electric playback system. And my panel yesterday had some patents from showing, you know, the stuff, the reproducer and the and the horn. So that's the quickie.
Exhibitions in those two?
Concert and exhibition. Good point. One spring, single spring motor, triple spring motor, quadruple spring motor. 50-some feet of, I forget the springs. It's spring wound. And spring wound in 1925, for nothing more than convenience and the fact that electricity is still kind of a mixed bag out there. Moreover, it's also priced. In December, let's say Christmas season, 1925, this was $275, which by straight CPI is 37 and change today, 100, or 3,700 plus. The all-electric machines, which were being introduced exactly at the same time, beyond the scope of this conversation, were much more expensive and weighed a ton. And some were batteries, some were socket power, et cetera, et cetera. So this was still a very expedient way to get a machine that could play the new fangled electrical recordings, which had been introduced kind of softly during 1925. So I'll tell you what. When I play some more records, I don't want to stand up here and talk all day. Just need a break from chasing records. I've still got to find a couple here, so we'll take. I'll announce the next one here. The next one is called Down South. Sort of Americana. Going to start with. A band version around 1902, Bess Ostman around 1909, Harry Reeser 1927, and then Nat Schildkret in the Ever Ready Hour Orchestra or whatever, 1927. The two 1927s are different venues and a different style. So we'll start with this while I chase more records. And there's also a speed difference with this one too.
I said good. I want to hear this one.
The other, well, I will mention this after another point I want to make.
Come on, downfall, way, way downfall, where the sun shines every day. Soft skies of blue smile down on you, and all the birds are singing clear and gay. Come on, the song, join in the song, jump on board, it won't be long. We're on the way, this is hooray. We're going downtown. Thank you.
performances. Oh, sorry, guys. Sorry about that. Microphone. This modern technology, guys, it's really tripping me up. Gotta plug myself in. Okay. Now I'm rebooted. Okay. Different performances, different recording technology. I mean, variants on the thing. What's going on here with this last one is it was recorded at Liederkranz Hall, which is one of the many halls that Victor used in New York. But what's curious about that, and what's interesting about period machines, is there is a level of resolution here that if you've been listening to these things for 50 years, you start to hone into. And I didn't realize this was Liederkranz Hall, of course, until the database came out. And one day I started looking around, and I noticed Liederkranz Hall, this record. Yeah, that's one of the ones that sounds really good. So on and so on and so on. Finally, I just said, let's look up Liederkranz Hall. Boom, 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 boom. It's amazing. Some of the records in my collection I thought sounded just that little bit better on this puppy. Forget about modern equipment. Liederkranz Hall. And there was something with the hall and whoever was doing the recording that they just stand out. Now, this one's a little bit more removed. You'll notice it was a little bit further back. The Harry Reeser was more forward, which in some respects is kind of a typical early orthophonic sound. A little bit more, you know, 1927, they start getting a little bit more forward. 1925, they're still a little bit more in the back. But I thought it was a good balance of recording technology, which is kind of what this is about, or actually the toys. So tell you what, let's listen to a little different. We'll go to a vocal. This is an acoustic, 1923, Marian Anderson doing Deep River. If I can get it on the thing, okay, in that room now. Different tack here. So So far, we've been Caruso-free. He didn't escape. For the simple reason that if someone is going to ask me in four words or less to define what goes, you know, the acoustic Victor versus the orthophonic Victor, Caruso dance band would be that simple as far as stuff that you would put on that would get people's attention, be impressive. And Victor put a lot of time and energy into promoting Caruso, so we'll play a little excerpt just so you can see what it sounds like. And then we'll put something over here that's kind of fun. I've been trying to kind of move it along a little bit so we're not, you know, eating lunch at banquet time. Although lunch is, you know, we can do whatever we want, but. Other companies. Actually, the Viva Tonals were excellent. Mm-hmm. They were some of the best, really. Reproduction Zonophone on this day. Julian Terrio's drill is trying to find the spin.
No.
Again, a reproduction. Again, that's a reproduction he made. It's a Zonophone original. Looks like this. Yeah, I think it's an interesting project. I have probably done what would be my allotted time. I mean, I can play records for, well, I have to actually pack this stuff up at some point. Take these off so I can, oh, there you guys are.
Keep going, they like you in Korea.
Do they?
Yes.
Are we being live streamed?
Yes.
For real? Okay, Korea, what do you want to hear?
He liked Lee DeCrince Hall.
Want to hear the White Album on it?
And Luna de Estate. He'd like it.
That's the coolest presentation I've ever seen.
Thank you. I can. Actually, you know what I want to do? You guys mind if I play a couple more excerpts? Okay. Yeah. Nick, this is for you. I have test pressings. I told you. So let's play, I'm going to do two. I'm going to play a bit of test pressing. One's acoustic and one's electric. The acoustic is not musically all that significant, but the sound quality is rather interesting. We just have to find it, folks.
Marian Anderson sounded better for the 23 on the 5.
Yeah. Your intonation hadn't started to deteriorate.
Yeah, well, I think it was bad balanced. The London recording was badly balanced.
And
I think
it might have been a little slow.
Too much on the piano.
Yeah.
It's the recording's fault.
The other thing, too, is with the 5, you're off the ground. And, you know, this is actually a great spot, you know, for projection. This puppy's getting eaten up by all the stuff.
Yeah.
You know, furniture, I guess, is what you'd call it. The problem with test pressings is they're kind of hard to read because they're black.
Hi, could you take one acoustic and put it on the credenza and an electric on the phonograph?
Oh, I could even do more. I can play a Victrola 2 on the reproducer.
Well, let's play the same record on one machine and then the other.
Yeah, I can do all kinds of stuff. You just have to find
the photo.
Oops.
Yeah,
okay. This is part 2.
This is the education department for bands, like for school bands.
Thank you.
you know, you see it actually had quite a bit of oomph to it. So let's do this. Let's just throw it on the big boy here. Sound check earlier, When a Black Man's Blue, Duke Ellington. This is 1930 really seemed to be the sweet spot for electricals that you can still play on these. You get into 31 is pretty good. 32, they start getting a little bit strident.
The SHQs, yeah.
In 29, they've introduced the RE45 and 75, which use push-pull 45s, and it's a different sound. The electrical equipment prior was using 10s and 50s, which had a brighter sound to them. And let's face it, you're going to tune to what you listen to. So when they first did electrical recording, this was what their standard was. And then pretty soon they were, you know, using their heavy artillery, the electrolas. Anyways, this is pretty well recorded. It has wear, so it's not going to be perfect, but it will get the point across. Then I'll take questions.
Not a song from the fields of cotton. but a mammy would hardly true. And a man young would live about 11. Well, a black man do. Stick a lily so wild and jolly. They are hushed by a mammy's eyes when they're home. But it's so quiet and melancholy. Even they show their sad right. That is born in your own plantation. Make the white folks unhappy. And the voice of the blue still a sound like. Will a black man move it?
So we do have some time for questions, but I want to make sure that you have enough time to pack up and everything.
Yeah, I got it.
And then everyone who wants to grab lunch can. But I don't want to stop the conversation. I need to, though. I feel like I'm coming into my role as a parent. It's time to put away your records and go to bed.
If you have, we can do a couple of questions. I mean,
oh, of course, yeah.
Five, maybe, and then, yeah, I got to start moving some stuff out of here. No, okay, I'm, bye. Bye.
So many people say that the credenza is dependent, its sound quality is dependent upon the reproducer. It sounds like maybe the reproducer on this is tuned more to the lower frequencies than the high frequencies. I was, you know, because some of the vocals sounded a lot better on the five,
yeah.
And of course, there's no bass on the five in comparison to the credenza.
Right. Well, there's two things. One is you have the, you know, the reentrant horn, so there's a bit of loss there.
Yeah.
And two, yeah, I tuned the reproducer for bass. I did it two ways. One is I made, you know, gaskets out of silicone rubber, which are softer than the impregnated fiber. And two, you know, it takes multiples to make one. You know, 20-some years ago, I bought six brass orthophonic reproducers and mixed and matched and pulled the diaphragm I like. Moreover, I tuned it for a smaller room. Now, I've had this in big rooms where it's had a better balance. It's also dependent on air pressure, humidity, and stuff in the room, and acoustics. This room's not bad, but I agree it was a little bit, you know, I mean, I could hear it up here.
Yeah.
And this, you know, look, I belong to the New Jersey Audio Society, so you have all the golden ear people, and they're pretty perceptive. And some of the guys actually like that quite a bit for just what you mentioned. Yeah, so, yeah.
What needles were you using, especially on the orthophonic? I'm just curious.
I'm using medium tone needles that used to be supplied by Phono Service, and I have no idea where to get them. That was in Liverpool. He died, who knows how many years ago. And then there was another gentleman that was selling them who didn't read emails very well, and I was able to get some, and now he's gone out of the business, so I don't know who's taken over. So that's the short answer. The long answer is you got to look around. I mean, if you find, actually in England, there's a guy named John Sleep, just like Betty Bye. He makes a medium tone needle that's longer, kind of like the Victor half tones. You notice I said medium tone. Hmm. The needle I absolutely abhor are those loud tone needles that look like, you know, shanks with a extruded end. You want a polished steel needle. Antique Phonograph supplies of soft tones are good, and it takes a little, you know, you got to get used to it. I'm sorry, I can't speak English. I mean, I'll use the soft tones on this in a small room, at first it sounds a little dull, but then you kind of, you know, a little brown liquid late at night, it comes into its own. Needles, one point about the mechanical phonograph is a lot of people think there's no control. There's actually quite a bit of control besides throwing something in the horn, and it's needles. The length of the needle, the thickness, has a lot to do with the characteristic. Moreover, you can always pull the needle, you know, it doesn't have to go all the way in. Yeah. And then the luck of the draw, you just, you know, the exhibition reproducer has a certain sound. Some are better than others because of magic, you know, diaphragms and things like that. Dave.
I saw you changing the speed. Aren't these all recorded at 78?
No.
Well, that's a leap.
Troll.
Where did that?
No, they're not.
Oh my God.
In fact, since you asked, this guy has markings inscribed, and one of the markings is 76.
It's one of those.
Yeah, yeah, it doesn't. There ain't no 78 yet. There isn't any 78. The rain in Spain and all that. This, forget about it. You know, Berliners is typically what, 70?
72, 67.
Yeah, exactly.
81.
Here's a rule of thumb I use. Victor's, I sort of assume 76 to start, just as my general, let's get into the ballpark. And that's pretty much it. Crusoe's are fairly easy because there's data up this Azu. But there's another thing too, is I've also noticed, like with Caruso's way back when I just one day was bored and decided to do a little database work, is that it seems like the Caruso's recorded in Camden tended to map to 75. The ones in New York tended to be more into 76. They say 76.6. Let's face it, that's something, that's a whole different story. But anyway, so yeah, that's kind of where I start. Columbia's, I don't believe, at 80. When Dave's mentioned Columbia's, it can be quite slow. You just have to listen to them. And that was the thing. They had speed controls for a reason. You know, people have ears. And people played back then, so they assumed people were musically literate enough make the change. Also, George Brock Nonstedt has talked about this, and I think he put it, it was in an AES paper, plus on ARSC list, yeah. What they called stagger tuning. All the record companies were concerned about record wear. The last thing you want to do is sell some guy a 75 cent or a $3 Caruso record and have that high bellow just blow the record apart after 20 or 30 plays. And that's what Smalling was talking about. Steve, you're around here somewhere? There you are. Steve's presentation last year with normalization, so, you know, to contain record wear. So the speed thing, recorded 76, playback at 78, just kind of shifted the resonant. You know, kind of the Tacoma Narrows, you know, thing, kind of avoid that. How's that for a scientific explanation?
Yeah, the horn resonance, we're thinking about the horn resonances matching in the recording versus the playback.
It's actually the reproducer resonance.
Yeah.
Because
I know George had borrowed some horns from EMI to test the horn resonances to see how they matched the playback horns of the day. To see if the doubling of the horn resonances in both directions would increase the wear, and that would be why they said they recorded 76, playback at 78.
Right.
The instructions say, you know, there are people that adjust the speed control. They're wrong. Don't do it.
Yeah. Well.
But they're the right ones.
And occasionally you will see Victor reference 76 too.
No.
Rarely.
Yeah, a couple catalogs said 76 like that one.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I think on that note, we're going to have to call it quits just to make sure that everybody has a chance to set up for the next panel and everyone gets a chance to get some food before the 1:30 panels. Again, I want to thank all of our presenters today. This is a wonderful panel.